Okay, good morning everyone. Thank you for joining class. We'll begin. I'll ask Vijay to come and lead us in prayer, please. Vijay is our first year student and he is from Andhra Pradesh, right? Yes.
Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this morning. Lord, we are going to study. We are going to be in the class. Lord, give us wisdom and knowledge so that we can treasure your words in our minds and work through them. Lord, thank you for everything. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Vijay. Okay, so Vijay is from Andhra Pradesh and he helps us in our setting up of the classroom for the online students. Thank you, Vijay. Okay, we were looking at chapter 4 in Receiving God's Guidance. Chapter 4, the inner witness of the Holy Spirit. So we're looking at ways God guides us. He guides us to His Word. He guides us to the Holy Spirit. There are different ways the Holy Spirit guides us and leads us. One way He leads us and guides us is through the inner witness, okay? And through the inner witness, how does the Holy Spirit, guide us and leads us? He communicates to us. We're looking at 8 different ways that He communicates and guides us and leads us, the Holy Spirit. The first one is quickening of Scripture. Yes, the Word. Second one is the assurance within. Third, the desire within. Fourth, the knowing within. Fifth, the prompting. Sixth is the steering. Seventh is the foreknowledge. And eighth is the warning. Okay, so we looked at how He quickens the Word through Scripture. And remember, I tried to give you an example last Friday, but I did not give you the specifics. So I found the testimony, so I just thought I will share with you, so you will know how God leads us even through Scripture. Okay, so here this testimony is about a young man in 2019. He was looking for a change in job. He attended a few interviews and then finally he decided, he was left with a choice between two companies. One is a company called Digital Ocean and the second one is a Fortune 40 company. Okay, and he was confused. Both were good. He was confused which one to choose. So he started seeking God's will. He started praying. And while reading the Psalms that day after praying, and he's thinking about it, he's asking God, and he was reading the book of Psalms. And Psalms chapter 24 verse 2 says, "He built it on the deep waters beneath the earth and laid its foundation in the ocean depths." He did not understand this verse fully, but he felt, ocean, reference to ocean. So he thought it was a digital ocean, and then that God is telling him to join that company because he read deep waters here. And he kept reading, and two more verses just jumped at him. One is Psalm 29 verse 3, where it says, "The voice of the Lord is heard on the seas, the glorious God thunders, and His voice echoes over the oceans." Okay, Psalm 36 verse 6, which is another psalm he read, says, "Your justice is like the depths of the sea." So the more verses he's reading, it's talking more about sea and ocean. And then he read one more verse, Psalm 37 verse 3, where it says, "Live in the land and be safe." Now land, he was thinking, refers, God is telling him of the Fortune 40 company that he was planning to go forward with. Okay, because he saw all these references talking about water and sea and ocean, he thought maybe God is telling him you have to join the digital ocean. So he told a Fortune 40 company that he doesn't want to join them, and he said yes to the digital company. And the Fortune 40 company, they called him back and they said, they gave him a good job offer, they gave him a senior role, and also they said they will give him a 200% increment, which is impossible in the industry. Very rare, where people usually get 30 to 40% increase in the IT company, but this is 200%. Okay. So then, he was confused. because God is showing him digital ocean, and now this Fortune 40 company is giving him 200% hike, and he's giving him senior position role. So he decided, let me go back to the Bible and read. So when he was reading, you know, he was just praying, God guided him through this passage in scripture, which, you know, Psalm 37 verse 3 says, live in the land and be safe. Live in the land and be safe. And then he knew that, you know, God was actually telling him to be on land, which is, you know, join the Fortune 40 company and not the the digital ocean. And then he says that he, you know, he joined that company and he's very happy. And he testified, he wrote to, APCtestimony.org, and he was just sharing how God guides us in and through his word. Okay, so we see that, you know, God leads us through his word. All of us can testify to the fact when we have experienced God leading us through his word. Okay, so we looked at the assurance within, we looked at the desire, and we looked at the knowing as well, right? And the prompting within, we were basically looking at the stirring within. Yes, the sixth way that the Holy Spirit guides us through the inner witness. Okay, and we looked at a couple of examples. We looked at Nehemiah's example, and we looked at how God stirred up the heart of the Israelites to give in, stirred up their hearts to give for the building of the tabernacle. Okay, they all came, they gave gold, silver, they gave, some of them started, making all those curtains and all of that. And also God gave, the Holy Spirit gave special creativity to Beelzebul and Bezalel and Aholiab, who did all the equipments, who made all the equipments necessary for the tabernacle. And we also saw Nehemiah, how God stirred up his heart. You know, it was such a deep stirring in his heart that it led him to go back to Jerusalem and to build the walls of Jerusalem. And how do we know it? Because he says, we are on page number 58. So we see that Nehemiah says that, I told no one what God has put in my heart to do at Jerusalem. So it was God who put it in his heart and told him what he needs to do. We look at two more examples. Another example is about how God, you know, when the King Cyrus sent back the Israelites back to Jerusalem, you know, he said, go back to your own place, you know, build your own country, your own towns, and settle down. And people came back and they started building their own homes, but the house of the Lord was in ruins. Okay, the temple was in ruins. They did not bother about God's temple. You know, so God stirred up the heart of the governor. He stirred up the heart of the high priest. He stirred up the heart of the few people. And after 16 years, you know, God stirred up their hearts and led them to build the temple. And we see that Haggai and, and Zechariah, their prophecies during this time actually strengthened the people to build the house of God, to build the temple. Okay, another example we see about stirring within, how the Holy Spirit leads us to stirring within. We already looked at this point in fulfilling God's purpose for your life. Do you remember? Yes. Okay. So, you know, when Paul was in Athens, that is in Greece, you know, when he came to that city of Athens, he looked that there were so many idols. Okay, and that stirred up his heart to really preach and teach the gospel. So he was so stirred up in his heart that he started preaching and teaching the gospel. Okay, so we also said when we were learning and fulfilling God's purpose for your life, we said, you know, there can be sometimes this emotional sneering that comes. You know, when we look at poor people, or we look at women who are battered, or, you know, beaten up, or, you know, look at drunkards in the street, or when we hear about, some orphanage, somebody comes and shares, you know, our heart will be stirred up. We might even cry. We might feel sad. We might not even have our lunch or dinner for that day. But then it kind of dies out. But for some of us, the stirring is so strong, it does not die till we do something about it, till we, you know, take action, till we bring about what God wants us to do. So that is the stirring is led by the Holy Spirit, and it's not just the emotional stirring that happens in our lives. Okay, so there are a couple, there is some personal examples that pastor has given on page, his own personal example in page number 59, 60, and 61, so you can read that later. Okay, we'll move on to the next way the Holy Spirit, his inner witness in our spirit is through the foreknowledge within. Okay, we know that our God is a God who speaks, is a God who reveals. He reveals things not just for our present and for our immediate future, but he can even reveal things way into the future, 10 years the future, what you want, what he wants you to do, where he wants you to go, what he wants you to fulfill. Okay, can God do that? Yes, God can do that. He can reveal his mind to the Holy Spirit, to us. He can give us a foreknowledge of the things concerning our lives, concerning our future, so that we need to we can prepare for it. But it's important for us to be willing to listen. Okay, when we listen, we can receive. Okay, there are two scripture passages there. Isaiah chapter 42 verse 9, it says, God says, you know, behold, the former things have come to pass. That means whatever I want to do in your life has come to pass. But new things I declare before they spring forth, I tell you. Okay, so we see that, you know, God reveals even 400 years into, you know, or, you know, generations, he can reveal, you know, or thousands of years, he can reveal what is going to happen. For example, Abraham, right? He told Abraham that your, what did he reveal about his descendants? Your descendants will be as slaves in Egypt for 400 years. He's revealing after, you know, he's revealing it to him many, 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 many years before. He tells him 400 years that they will be as slaves in an unknown place, okay? But I will deliver them. I will take them to the promised land. I will bring them back to this land. So we see that, you know, many generations also pass, but God still can reveal things to people, okay? He also revealed that, you know, the Israelites will go into captivity for how many years? 70 years. Okay, 70 years captivity. So everything God reveals in things in the future that is going to happen. So it's not only for his chosen people, so-called chosen people, the Israelites. We are all his chosen people because we are now we belong to the church. So does God reveal to us what will happen 10 years down the line in our life? Yes, he will reveal. He will prepare it for, why does he reveal it to us? So that he can prepare us for it and we can get prepared for it. Okay, so you know, this is what pastor gives in his own life example on page number 63. He says one day on in May in 1993, he just sat down and he tried listening to the Holy Spirit, and on a piece of paper he just started writing all that he wants to do the next 10 years of his life. Okay, and he said it's, you know, he just felt there were things that the Holy Spirit was putting in his heart. Some things, maybe his own will, he just wrote it down. And then when he looked back after that 10 years, everything that he had written on that piece of paper was accomplished. So that's what motivated him. And so he again started to do that. You know, he'll plan for the next 10 years. So he plans every 10 years of his life in advance, and he asked the Holy Spirit to lead him and guide him. So you can also do that, and the Holy Spirit would lead us and guide us as well. Okay, we look at the last way the Holy Spirit, the inner witness of the Holy Spirit, is through warning within. The Holy Spirit warns us. Okay, how does he warns us? How does he warn us? To the inner witness. Yes, one of the ways is the inner witness is the warning. How does he warn us? Through scripture, through visions, through dreams, through people. Remember I told you about the red signal and the green signal? Peace, yes. When you have the peace in your heart, it's God telling, when you're praying about something, you know, he won't hear an audible voice, or you won't feel an impression in your spirit man saying yes. But you will just feel amazing peace. You'll feel amazing joy. That means God is telling you, go ahead, do it. Okay, I this is my will. I approve of it. But sometimes, you know, there is restlessness, there's anxiety. We feel very tight in our spirit, man. We feel uneasy. We lack the peace and joy. And we feel that something is just not right. When you feel like that, it's better to, you know, just wait and stop. And it's actually the Holy Spirit telling you, don't go ahead. Okay, stop. You know, she's cautioning us. So it can be even in little things. Okay. Like I told you, my dad, whenever he goes out anywhere, my mother will ask him to even go buy tomatoes at the store, he'll go to the prayer room, he'll pray and he'll go. So, you know, he says he just feels the inner witness of the Holy Spirit telling him, okay, go ahead. But he says, you know, one day when my uncle passed away, it was on Easter that he passed away, my dad's younger brother. My dad was praying to go and buy a mutton from the meat store, okay? And he just didn't feel the peace. He just felt restless. So he just waited for 5-10 minutes. He was just doing something. My mother was saying, go up, hurry up, it's getting late. And then he went back again to the prayer room. And again, he felt no peace. He felt just restlessness. He felt spirit saying, don't go. I mean, so he was wondering why he didn't tell mom, he didn't tell son. And then he just waited again. And then, you know, the phone rang and we heard that, you know, his younger brother passed away. And so we see even little things, you know, when we're constantly depending and waiting on the Holy Spirit, even in little things, he will tell us where to go, what to do, what to speak, who not to, what not to say to this person, or, you know, you want to step in and do something, what you should not be doing, what you should be doing. So in every little area of our life, the Holy Spirit leads us and guides us. Okay, one example here is in Acts chapter 20 verses 22 to 23, where it says that, Paul says that, you know, the Holy Spirit always tells him, that he's going to face chains. Chains means he's going to be imprisoned. He's going to be put into prison. He's going to face tribulations, which means he's going to face hardships. Okay, and he says, the Holy Spirit testifies to him that he's going to face all of this. He's going to face imprisonment. He's going to face hardships. And so, the Holy Spirit testifies. Testifies means what? To charge, to affirm. Okay, so, Paul is going to Jerusalem, and the Holy Spirit, gives him a feeling where he's bound in the spirit. That means he feels very tight in the spirit. He feels constrained. He doesn't feel the freedom. He feels something is just holding him back. And that's one way the Holy Spirit was testifying, or affirming or telling him, through the sensation of discomfort that, there is something that's not very good that is going to happen to him in Jerusalem. So when he shares it with all the disciples, all his teammates, they say, please don't go to Jerusalem. But, Paul knows that he has to go to Jerusalem, and hence he goes to Jerusalem. And that's what happens. He's imprisoned over there. Okay. So even when we are making decisions, small or big, when we can receive warning in our spirit, sometimes we want to go along with somebody, do something, the Holy Spirit says, don't. We want to venture into a business, we think about X, Y, Z, and, the Holy Spirit gives us a warning. He does not give us a comfortable feeling. It's actually telling us, stop. Don't do it. Don't go. You know, want to go for a vacation, but, the Holy Spirit, there's no freedom, there's no peace, there's joy. And then you can sense, okay, maybe this is not the place where the Holy Spirit wants me to go. So he can lead you and guide you in every way. But we need to pause and need to wait on the Holy Spirit, and we need to be very sensitive to the Holy Spirit. So every time when we are reading the word and praying, speak in tongues, pray in tongues often, communicate with the Holy Spirit. So when you have to make important decisions in life, even small ones, you will feel the prompting, you'll feel the leading, you will know that it is the Holy Spirit very definitely. Okay, so we need to train ourselves to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. So how do we become sensitive to the Holy Spirit? Firstly is we spend time in worship, word and prayer, you know, constantly communicate with the Holy Spirit throughout the day. Keep asking him, what should I say? What should I do? Which song should I choose for the worship? You know, this person is looking a little sad. What can I tell this person? Or this person has done something wrong. Holy Spirit, help me to communicate in the right way to this person. So, you know, we also can pray a lot in tongues. We don't have to just sit and close our eyes. You know, when you're driving or you're coming or you're just, you know, even cleaning the hostel, you're going somewhere, you know, just keep speaking in tongues, you know, praying in tongues. Okay. And also important to be still in your and quiet in your spirit. Some of us, our minds and our hearts are so active that we're not, you know, quiet and still to listen to the Holy Spirit. You know, we need to be very quiet and still. So, you know, one pastor, Pastor Bill Johnson, pastor of the Bethel Church, I remember in one of his sermons, he illustrated this very beautifully. He said, you know, when the Holy Spirit came on Jesus, it came like a dove. You know, dove is a very, very peaceful, very mild creature, right? And, you know, when and he says, when the dove is sitting on your shoulder, just imagine a dove is sitting on your shoulder. How will you move? How will you walk? Very slowly, very gently. You know, you won't be in a hurry. You won't scream. You won't shout. You won't, you know, why? Because that dove is there. So the same way the Holy Spirit is very gentle, mild, you know, peaceful person of the Trinity. So if you are very anxious and very hassled and very, I have to do this, I have to do that, so many things to do, you're doing all that, you cannot hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. So to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, you need to calm yourself down, your spirit man. And also you need to spend extra time in praise, worship, fasting, God's word, so that you can listen to what the Holy Spirit is saying and, you know, be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Okay. Also, we need, we said in the beginning of this chapter, how many ways we looked at the inner witness of the Holy Spirit? How many ways? Does he lead us and guide us? How many ways does the Holy Spirit, through the inner witness, lead us and guide us? 8 ways, okay? This is not just a hard, fast rule, okay? Just these 8 ways, the Holy Spirit can lead us in, you know, use any of these 8 ways, or he can even do anything else because he's God. He can, you know, he can do things in his own creative way. But this is just for our understanding and for our help. But we said the first one, scripture, you know, if the Holy Spirit reveals something from scripture to us, we can take it as something that is, you know, it can be acted upon immediately. But the other 7, okay, the knowing and the stirring and, you know, the warning and the knowledge within, all of these we need to confirm. Are you understanding? You need to confirm, because sometimes, you know, what can happen, you know, our own feelings, our own emotions, our own logical thinking, our own will can come into place and we can say, this is the Holy Spirit telling me. Cannot be the Holy Spirit, can be our own will, our own emotions. Sometimes it can even be demonic ideas and suggestions. You know, Satan can even put thoughts that are against God's plans and thoughts. I'll give you one example, right? Peter in Matthew chapter 16. You know, in Matthew chapter 16, Jesus asked the disciples, who do men say I am? Okay, so they say you're, you know, John the Baptist and Elijah and, you know, all of that great prophets. Then Jesus says, who do you say I am? So he's asking the disciples, who do you say I am? Okay, so what does Peter say? You are the Messiah, the Son of God. Okay, and what does Jesus tell him? Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. Which means he's saying that it's not your own knowledge, you know, but it's my Holy, the Father through the Holy Spirit has revealed it to Peter. And then, you know, Jesus goes on to tell them that, you know, he has to suffer many things and he's going to die. And what does Peter say? Huh? Let it be far from you. He says, this will not happen. And what does Jesus tell him immediately? He rebukes Satan. You know, he says, he rebuked the devil. So once he's telling Peter, hey, very good, you know, it's not flesh and blood, it's my Father who's revealed it to you. And then the very next thing he's telling about all the sufferings he's going through. And then, you know, Peter says, this will not happen to you. And what does Jesus rebuke Satan? Okay. So he's able to see the discerning spirit that is in Jesus. Discerning spirit is one of the gifts of the Spirit. Okay, to the same mouth, one is from the Father, to the same mouth, just in another instant, it came from the devil. Okay, so we need to be very careful to discern things, because sometimes even Satan can put in his ideas and his suggestions, just like the Holy Spirit can do. So we need to be very, very careful. And that is why we need to test each of these. The first one you needn't have to test, but all the other seven you need to test. How do you test it? You can keep praying, you can ask God to, you know, lead you and guide you, and also you can test it through scripture. Okay, now we look at some simple ways, tests to check what you are receiving through the inner witness. Okay, the first one is, you know, and we need to ensure whatever we are hearing from the Holy Spirit, it's in line with scripture. The second thing is, we need to ensure that our natural emotions and affections, you know, are kept subject to the Holy Spirit. You know, if we are very carnal minded, our emotions will all, and affections, our appetites, our desires will all be very carnal. Why? Because we are feeding our carnal man. But if you are feeding a spirit man, you know, continuously praying, reading God's word, you know, meditating on God's word, then our emotions, our appetites, our desires, everything will be subject to the Spirit. And then we will be able to, you know, also use our emotions to know what the Holy Spirit is telling us. Okay, so the Holy Spirit can even use our emotions. So because the Holy Spirit will know, here this is a mature person whose emotions are, you know, controlled by me, by my, you know, by the Holy Spirit. And so I can reveal, you know, through the emotion of this person, I can reveal what the person has to do. Okay. So we also need to know that whatever the Holy Spirit is giving us, the inner witness, it should be to the leading, it should be to glorify Jesus Christ. Okay. Whatever the Holy Spirit tells us, it will be to glorify Jesus Christ. If you see that it is something that is worldly, something that is carnal, something that is, you know, feeding your pride or jealousy or hatred, we are very sure that you've not heard it from the Holy Spirit. It is from Satan. For example, Satan said, don't forgive that person. You know, that person has been so rude to you. You know, and so that is actually, you know, discerning your desire. Yes, you know, how can that person do this to me? But we know this is not from the Holy Spirit. Okay, then we also need to see that if it's aligned God's overall plan and purpose. We looked at God's general purpose and plan, his eternal purpose and plan, and his specific purpose and plan. And then we can also ask the Holy Spirit to confirm it through the other ways. We looked at seven ways. You can confirm it through any other way, so we can receive some good confirmation. You know, sometimes there is risks involved when the Holy Spirit tells us to do something. For example, the Holy Spirit will tell you to tell somebody something. You know, you can just, it's a risk, but you can just take the phone or you can go tell that person, hey, this is what I heard. Is it right? If the person says, no, it's not right, don't be disappointed. You know, you're just learning to sense what the Holy Spirit is leading you and guiding you to tell people, or, you know, to use the, you know, to activate the gifts of the Spirit in your life. But you know, you can do that. You can, and the friend will say, "Hey, it's okay, man. I mean, you just went meant it for my well-being." Or if you take the phone and you call up that person, anyway, what you said was not right, but at least you know we can get to talk to each other. It was nice to connect with you. So that ways. But you know, if you're making important decisions in life, like who to marry, where to go and do ministry, what ministry to do, you know, you need to wait and get confirmation from the Lord and more guidance from the Holy Spirit. Okay, so sometimes we also need to test and validate what we are hearing from the Holy Spirit, because as I said, our own emotions, our own wills, our own logical thinking, what our desires will come into place, and you know, we need to test and see if this is what the Holy Spirit is telling us. Okay, any questions you'll have about this chapter? Any questions? And a good way to test is just spend extended time in praying in tongues, you know, because when we pray in tongues, we are actually praying mysteries, but we are praying according to the will of God. It's a mystery to us, it's not a mystery to God. And, you know, the Holy Spirit will reveal the heart and mind of God into our spirit and will help our spirit man to understand what he's saying. So pray in tongues. You know, more often when you have to make decisions, important decisions, keep praying in tongues. And when you're praying in tongues, you know, just quieten your spirit so that you can hear from God and you can hear God clearly speak. Okay. Any questions anyone has? Online students? Any questions? Yes. You can take that mic, please, and so that our students also can hear.
Regarding foreknowledge within,
okay,
how God will reveal the things in future, like is it through dreams or scriptures? What way?
Okay, so foreknowledge within, how
in what way God will reveal to us?
Okay, so he can reveal it through different ways. He can reveal it to scripture. He can, we will look at how the Holy Spirit also reveals things to us through the inner voice, the audible voice, through prophecy, through visions, through dreams. He can give us a foreknowledge of what is going to happen in the future. And also you can, when you want to plan about your life, the next 5 years or 10 years, you can spend some time, some days, you know, an extended time just praying in the Holy Spirit. And then, you know, you feel this is the day today, I'll just take the paper and I'll just wait upon the Holy Spirit, what he's telling me. And, you know, even during those 10 days when you're praying, the Holy Spirit will tell you what you need to do. But he can also reveal it through visions, dreams, prophecies, through audible voice of the Holy Spirit, the inaudible voice of the Holy Spirit. You can hear what the Holy Spirit is telling you to do. Like for example, the Holy Spirit was telling me that I need to go to Bible college. How did I know about it? Because I started praying about it. I was desiring to know what the Holy Spirit was telling me. So, you know, and at the end of the day, when I would put out the lights and, you know, and finish my studies, it would be very late, 11:30, 12. I would spend some time in prayer. And then the Holy Spirit would clearly speak to me. It was an inaudible voice, but it was an impression in my spirit. But I knew very clearly, even at that age, when I didn't know the person and work of the Holy Spirit, because we came from a Methodist background, which we were not taught about, you know, the person and work of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, how the Holy Spirit speaks. But I just knew this was God speaking to me. I, you know, knew for sure. And I think God also gives us that affirmation that it's I who am speaking to you. See? And so this continued for 1 week. And I told you I didn't take it seriously. And in the end, what happened, right? How God reminded me again, you know, you said you're going to Bible college. So, yes. Okay, good question. Anyone else? Anyone else? Foreknowledge is like also knowing within. We just know within. You know, remember the one of the points that we learned, how the Holy Spirit guides us to the inner witness, knowing within. Also to the knowing within, but this is something that is, you know, he tells us way in, well in advance.
And one thing, like, ma'am, during for us in our supernatural hours, some persons see something for us, like they tell, like, I saw this picture for you. Can it also be the foreknowledge about our future?
Yes, it could be. It could be, that is what we will learn through the gifts of the Spirit, word of wisdom, word of knowledge. Word of wisdom is something that, you know, God is telling you something in the future that's going to happen, how you can plan. Word of knowledge is something that, you know, he's reminding something about the past that you need to deal with now in the present, or something in the present that he's telling you to do. So yes, he can reveal it to word of knowledge, prophecy, to word of wisdom as well. Good questions. Yes, Rin. I hope online students, you're able to listen to the questions. So the student asked, you know, when we have supernatural hour in the Bible college, So he's just saying that, you know, when people say that I saw this about, saw this vision or dream about you, then, so you got it. So I don't have to explain. Okay, we'll have a question from Rin. Yes, Rin.
About a warning within.
Yes.
So it talks about Paul, like how the Holy Spirit warned him about trouble waiting for him in Jerusalem. Mm. But he went against that. He disobeyed.
Okay. So actually, we don't see here that the Holy Spirit. It's a good question. I knew this question might come up from some student when I was preparing this. So good question. So we see that, you know, we see the Holy Spirit is warning him ahead of time, preparing him for what is going to happen in Jerusalem, but he's not stopping him from going to Jerusalem. Because we look at another example, when the Holy Spirit, when Paul and his team are actually, I'll give you the reference. When Paul and his team are actually going to Acts chapter 13, verses 1 to 3, Acts chapter 16, verses 6 to 10, Paul and his team have gone to Galatia. Okay, so when from Galatia, they want to go and preach the word in Asia, but the Holy Spirit tells them, forbids them to go to Asia. Then they come to Mysia, and when they come to Mysia, they want to go to Bithynia. But again, the Holy Spirit does not permit them. Okay, so here Paul and his team have clarity. The Holy Spirit is saying, don't go to that place. And then we read on later on in the same passage, Acts chapter 16, where the Holy Spirit tells Paul in a vision to go to Macedonia. And he goes. So here, the Holy Spirit is not telling Paul, don't go to Jerusalem. The Holy Spirit is warning him about what is going to happen in Jerusalem so that he can be well prepared for it. He knows what to do. You know, what action to take, how to be well prepared, what he needs to take when he's going, because he's going to go to imprisonment. Should not come like a surprise, because then he will say that, God, you never forewarned me, you never told me, you never prepared me for this. So here we just see the goodness of God, and he actually forewarns us. Yeah. Like, for example, I'll give you an example. One day in the morning, I think around 4-ish, you know, God wakes me up. And the burden in my heart to just pray for my dad and my sister. A deep stirring. So I don't know what to pray for them, because I'm not getting any clarity, but I just start praying in tongues. And I pray with such burden. I just keep praying and praying and praying. And this is the Holy Spirit leads me. And then later on in that day, my dad and my sister have an accident. You know, but it was a major accident, but nothing really happened to them. Just a little bruise here and there, but nothing major happened to them. And then I was just so thankful, because then I realized that the Holy Spirit woke me up and asked me to pray for my father and my sister, and why he asked me to do it. And I didn't know what I was praying, but just praying in tongues and praying in the Spirit, and just led me to do that. Okay. That's a good question, Rin. Thank you. Anyone else has any questions? Any questions from our online class? Okay, Prince says, warning from the Holy Spirit can be also to prepare us. Yes, can also be to prepare us. Yes, basically to prepare us not to go to that place, not to engage in that business, not to partake in what someone else is telling you to do. They might come, some people can subtly, you know, very nicely come and ask you for help, and you are a very nice person wanting to help them in their need, but the Holy Spirit will warn you and saying, you know, the person is actually taking your help, you know, to make use of you in the wrong way. Okay, asking you, and finally you're going to get into trouble with this person. So don't, you know, involve with that person. Don't go ahead with that person. Don't, you know, join this team, or don't do whatever you're supposed to do. Or don't take this person on your team, because this person is not going to really benefit the team. So even when I have to, I was handling two teams, you know, and whenever I choose people for the teams, I always pray and ask the Holy Spirit to lead me and guide me if this is the right person to come into the team. Because if the wrong person comes to the team, they're going to give you a lot of trouble, which is unnecessary, unwanted trouble. And it can just burden you. It can destroy the work, the peace of mind. It can cause a lot of division. Important to pray and ask the Holy Spirit even for guidance in that area. Okay. So yes, it's a warning from the Holy Spirit. It prepares us. Isn't that wonderful how the Holy Spirit warns us, guides us, you know, present, regarding, reveals things about the past and also about the future. Okay, we'll move on to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Another way the Holy Spirit reveals to us is not just through the inner witness, but also through his voice. Okay, so, you know, on page number 71, there are a few, you know, few verses there, scripture verses from Ezekiel, Acts, Acts chapter 8, Acts chapter 10, and Acts chapter 13. So we see that, you know, how the Holy Spirit led Ezekiel, how the Holy Spirit led Philip to go near the chariot, to overtake the chariot of the eunuch who was reading from Isaiah, the you know, and how he leads him to accept Jesus as his personal savior. Also, we see in Acts chapter 10 how the Holy Spirit reveals to Peter in a vision, you know, all, and shows him all these unclean things and tells him, you know, don't call what God has created clean as unclean. And then he tells him, three men are waiting downstairs, go without any questions. So he goes to Cornelius's house, who's a Gentile, and you know, they receive the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, without even Peter praying. And Peter's shocked, how can these Gentiles, not Jews, they're not Jews, how can Gentiles be baptized in the Holy Spirit? How can they receive the gifts of the Holy Spirit? So then he remembers, oh yeah, Jesus, you know, I received this vision, and this is what the meaning of the vision is. And then also we see that, you know, when the elders and believers in the early church were fasting and praying, the Holy Spirit revealed to all of them collectively, you know, saying, set apart Barnabas and Saul for the work of the Lord. Okay, so we see how the Holy Spirit speaks to us in different ways. Now, you know, Holy Spirit speaks in specific, how he specifically spoke to these people. We see that, but it does not mention that how the Holy Spirit spoke to them, whether it's an inner witness, whether it is an inner voice, whether it's an audible voice, it is through prophecy. But only thing they say is the Holy Spirit spoke to them. So the, you know, the Holy Spirit can speak to us in the inner witness, which is the most common way that the Holy Spirit speaks to us. But sometimes the Holy Spirit can even speak through an audible voice or an inner voice. An inner voice is when there is no, does not use the medium of sound. We don't hear the sound, but we know that the Holy Spirit is speaking to us. But sometimes the Holy Spirit can speak with an audible voice. Okay, so when the Holy Spirit actually speaks, how do we know it's not the inner witness? Because it's much stronger. Okay, so when the Holy Spirit is using the inner voice or the audible voice of the Holy Spirit to communicate and guide us and lead us, it's much stronger than the inner witness. Okay, it's much stronger, and we receive you know, leading and guiding. And it's the voice is released in our spirit man, and it's much stronger and much clearer. And the Holy Spirit uses his voice to instruct us and direct us. Now, the inner voice of the Holy Spirit basically comes through impressions. Impressions means you just know. It's an impression. You know, when you impress something on this table, it can just stay. You just feel that. I know that's the Holy Spirit telling me. You don't hear a voice, or you don't feel like you've heard a voice. Okay, but inner witness comes through impressions and also through words. Okay, inner witness comes through impressions in our spirit man, and the voice of the Holy Spirit comes through words. Okay, impression means you can just sense things, you can just feel things, you can just know what the Holy Spirit is saying. But if it's the inner voice or the audible voice of the Holy Spirit, then you can hear words, clear words. Okay, so for example, you know, once we were doing ministry time and on stage in Central during the service, and I just came up on stage and I'm just praying and saying, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to pray for? And I hear this, you know, ears. I just heard ears. I just felt like it was not a voice, but it was, I know it was like it, that word just came, ears came, and it was like somebody speaking to me, but I didn't hear the voice. So sometimes it's just the inner voice. Sometimes it can be just an impression. So you know that you've heard it with your ear. Sometimes you can just feel the impression inside your heart, in your spirit man. So you know when it's an impression, you know it's an inner witness. But when you hear it like coming pop in your ears, then you know it's the inner voice or the audible voice of the Holy Spirit. So we look at the two ways, the inner voice and the audible voice of the Holy Spirit. The inner voice is when the Holy Spirit is clearly speaking to us, but we don't hear a sound. It's let's not use the medium of sound, but we receive the message. For example, I gave you this example of how I just heard ear, and you know, just prayed for people with ear problems. So many of them in church were having ear problems, were healed. And there was one person online who was watching it, who was in the hospital, and he was having a severe ear problem, and it was so it was a major problem. I don't just remember the details, but he was admitted in hospital. It was very serious. The doctors didn't really know what to do. And when he heard that, you know, that the word of knowledge that came, he was so surprised. And I just prayed. He said, you know, healing came about. And the next Sunday, again, Pastor Nancy mentioned about ears, and he prayed. And then, you know, this person had received by then complete healing, and he was out of hospital. So, you know, we didn't hear, I heard the word, but not the voice. Okay, so there's no medium of voice that is used, but we received the message very, very clearly. So even when I was asking the Holy Spirit, God, what do you want me to do after my 12th grade? I could hear God speaking to me. There was no voice, but it was an inner voice. Okay, like, you know, I could hear the words. God is saying, go to Bible college. I can still remember. These are the words, go to Bible college. Okay, so I'll give you another instance. When I was once just having a meeting with the man of God, I was quite upset with that person. I was quite angry and upset. I was just sitting down there. I didn't have a right attitude as well. And then I was just listening to him. The Holy Spirit was telling me, it was an inner voice. I could hear these words clearly, but the voice did not come. But I could hear the words saying, you know, humble yourself and listen to the man of God. These are the exact words came. Humble yourself and listen to the man of God. And immediately, you know, it was like a, oh my gosh, you know, just sorry. And my heart was so humble before that man. I was you know, I said, yes, okay, I'll do this, whatever you want me to do, I'll do, and all of that. But the voice, the words came, but there was no the medium of voice was not there. Okay, so we look at if you look at page number 74 75, 76, 77 as well, Pastor is, and 78, Pastor is giving a couple of examples of how, you know, he, you know, felt leading and guidance in his life through the inner voice of the Holy Spirit. So the inner voice of the Holy Spirit is you hear the words, but you don't hear the sound. Okay, it just comes in your ear. But the inner witness comes through impression in your heart. You just feel, you just sense it in your heart and in your spirit. Okay. So Nina is asking, inner voice and audible voice is the same thing? No, inner voice is when you hear the words, but there is no medium of sound use. Audible voice is when you hear this voice, the sound of the Holy Spirit speaking. You can hear him speak. We'll do the, we will come back and then we will do the audible voice of the Holy Spirit. Okay, we'll take a break now and we'll come back after the break. Thank you, everyone.